Hi, welcome to Almost Cooperstown.
I'm Mark.
And this is Gordon. And we love talking about baseball.
So this podcast has discussed for years the idea that the PED players and the gambling players are not represented in the Hall of Fame at all. You can't really see much about them, and we act often as if these players, as far as the Hall of Fame is concerned, don't even exist.
Yeah, and it's just not right because, I mean, part of it is that there's always going to be some players that are left out of talking about the Hall of Fame tapestry of baseball, even if they might have been a Hall of Fame level talent in a particular season or even for a decent period of time. They just lack the full career credentials to get in there. I mean, if you're going to talk about the Hall of Fame pitchers of the 1980s, you're going to talk about a lot of guys. It's kind of hard not to talk about Doc Gooden at some point in there as the guy that beat a bunch of these guys for Cy Youngs.
And who decidedly is not a Hall of Fame pitcher, in our opinion.
Not a Hall of Fame pitcher, but you would have to talk about him because of how good he was. And then, you know, it's like, well, how do you not talk about some of these guys that are not in, you know, the Baseball Hall of Fame for various reasons, both good and, you know, well, not good, but both provably bad and assumed bad, that, you know, you can't have to deal with it, you know?
So we have an idea. And the idea is that there's a place in Cooperstown for these players, but it is not as an enshrined player into the Baseball Hall of Fame. They would be part of something that we are going to jokingly call, this is a bit of a lark here, the Corridor of Controversy within the Hall of Fame.
Now, originally, we were talking about this and we were going at this purely from an angle of players, but I actually think coming at it from an angle of concepts, one, allows it to be less like a weird little back way doorway of getting these
right,
guys.
Right, because totally
in the
that's what people are going to say.
That's what people are going to say, that, oh, you're just trying to get them in the hall.
And we are.
And we are. But we're not actually enshrining these guys in the Hall of Fame.
Now, there's a way that you could get out of the Corridor of Controversy and actually be voted in.
Is that if somebody just votes
you in? Now you're in the regular Hall of Fame with all the regular guys.
No,
and like
still,
a real Hall of Famer.
You'll still be in the Corridor
of Controversy, but you'll also be in the Hall of Famer.
Right, but because the idea is that, like, look, there are certain guys. Like, let's talk about one of the first controversies here, which I think is something that we have to say because of how long ago it happened and how it's happened to some of the biggest players of all time. It's undoubtedly a part of the game, and that's gambling.
Right, right. Number one, and the first guy you think of is Joe Jackson.
Yeah. Look at his career stats. They're unbelievable how good he was. But he was proven to have taken money for
or admitted to taking money.
Or admitted to taking money.
Even if he didn't spend it or didn't throw the games or anything like that, the fact remains that he is on the hook.
On record.
Right.
For having said, at the very bare minimum, saying, yes, I took money in agreement to lose the World Series.
So then what we do in Joe Jackson's case is we take our big eraser out and we make believe he never existed.
Which is dumb. And then we have Pete Rose, who is suspected of gambling on the Reds. And I think even he says he gambled on them. However, I think he claims that he just never gambled them.
I don't know if he was ever, if he ever admitted to betting in games, or maybe he admitted to not betting against the Reds.
I think he never.
Right. He only bet for them to win.
Bet for them to win, which, I mean, I guess on one hand, I'm like, really, what would be the issue with that? Like,
if he betted on the win,
if he's
right.
only betting on himself ever to win,
right?
Like if Bryce Harper went out and made a bet on himself to win MVP before the season, like, what are we going to do? Be like, oh, that's not allowed. Like, oh, I'm going to try really hard to be really good this year, guys.
And clearly in Pete Rose's case, it just seems to me, although I guess Joe Jackson would refute that kind of a thought, that they're waiting for Pete Rose to die and then they'll put him in the Hall of Fame.
Just so they don't have to do it while he's alive.
They don't want to give him the satisfaction of having lied like that.
I think you have the gambling because you could talk about that and other controversies in gambling things that have popped up through the ages because there have been other players far smaller scale that have been busted for both gambling on baseball and other gambling aspects that have been attracted to the league that's part of baseball. You can now talk about these guys, but they're not actually in the Hall of Fame.
So they're in this corridor of fame. These are the first two guys, right?
Yeah, the corridor of infamy, not fame.
Well, the corridor of controversy.
Yes.
The corridor of controversy. And so there's you can right away you can think about, okay, so now we're going to go to the other guys that are not there who we think would be there were it not
for PEDs.
For PEDs.
Right. And you can now tell all the story of the – because you would need to tell the story. What about guys like Ryan Braun?
Well, I included him sort of because he's not up yet.
Right, but he's not going to ever be a Hall of Famer.
And his stats were borderline, I think, but anyway.
He was going to be almost Cooperstown pretty much for sure, even without the steroid stuff.
But I think so.
But his saga is such a microcosm of the entire thing. His vociferous denial of being, you know, accused of using PEDs, singling out the poor employee, saying it was all this one guy's fault that was he was out to get him, only to kind of then backtrack and be like, well, yeah, I did it.
He is the Brewers' career leader in home runs. Okay. All right. That's nice. It's like 358. Like, okay, well, that doesn't really mean it.
Leading, unfortunately, leading a team in any statistical category that isn't like a Cub, Red Sox or Yankee team doesn't really matter.
So, but I think, and I'm not looking at Braun stats, and maybe you could pull it up. So, in addition to that, I think he hit just under 300 for his career.
He was a very good
on base percentage. Was not a very good defender. That would not, you know, and that probably would be as much as a thing like going, okay, so you hit home runs. You had a pretty good OBA. You had a good batting average.
He was a good player.
You're a good player. You're not a Hall of Famer, but, and you got the PED as well.
But in the corridor of controversy, he should be there because he should be talked about as what he represents to the controversy of PEDs in baseball. The same way guys like Palmeiro should be there, and Clemens should be there, and even McGuire and Sosa should all be there because you can't talk about PEDs without talking about them. The same way A-Rod should be enshrined as a player and talked about in the corridor of controversy. Both for doing just PEDs and just for being A-Rod, because he
So you think he should we think he should be in the Hall of Fame and in
the same way Bonds of controversy. Should be.
Yep.
McGuire should probably be in the Hall of Fame.
I think so too.
Sosa, no. I'm okay with keeping
just
Sosa.
Just keeping
out.
Him in the corridor of controversy. He doesn't get into the Hall of Fame.
I'm okay keeping in the corridor of controversy. Braun, always, because he was never going to be a Hall of Famer. But then you could even talk about things like drugs in baseball and bring up people like Daryl Strawberry and Dwight Gooden. Talk about that 86 Mets team.
They would all be in this corridor of controversy. Would Keith Hernandez be in there as well because of his battle with drugs in the 80s?
I think there's a place for talking about all of this stuff as part
to make believe, instead of making believe it just never happened at all.
Never happened, right. Because the Baseball Hall of Fame is as much the Baseball History Museum
yes.
as it is the Hall of Fame.
Yes, yes. And we go back to the thing we talk about all the time. So these 12 players, I think you've named about all of them. You didn't name a couple of guys that I had thrown onto my list. So Curt Schilling.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Curt Schilling, not necessarily PEDs.
But I think there's
just because he's kind of an asshole,
right? He was always going to be an edge case guy. But I think there's even
I think he's a Hall of Famer, by the way. I mean, if
unquestioned,
unquestioned Hall of Famer.
He's
unquestioned,
incredible stuff. But you know what? He hasn't gotten in yet, despite
no, because we don't like him.
No, which is
which is stupid.
which is exactly our problem.
We don't like his. Don't like his politics.
Which
people
is what
don't
we
like
said back
attitude.
In our induction episode. Right. We talked about Ortiz being a first ballot guy because people liked him so much.
I spoke to a Red Sox fan this week about that, and I said, you know, we did the podcast, and he hadn't heard the podcast, and you know, and big Red Sox fan, all that kind of stuff. You know, we said we have no issue with Ortiz being in the Hall of Fame, but first ballot, really? Because if I'm other guys now, if I'm seeing Ortiz is the first ballot, and there's another guy on my list here, Gary Sheffield, raise your hand. Okay, he of the 290 career batting average, 509 career home runs.
Actually played the field the whole
played
time.
The field and all that stuff. So why does he not get any look at all? Like, we're not talking about first ballot. We're just saying so. And he's in the corridor of controversy because there was insinuation about PEDs.
But you know, no more so than Ortiz had.
Right. I think that's fair. And no more than Kevin Brown did.
Mm-hmm.
Right. There's another guy we've talked about.
Even Brown, I think Brown was even lesser than them because
right.
they figured out that it wasn't correct in his case.
And he's a guy who got whacked out of the Hall of Fame, and his name really never comes up. We've talked about him on this podcast a number of times. We believe he's a Hall of Famer.
Right. And I just think it's like the kind of thing where you need to talk about those guys. I also think you should have a blown call section.
Well, that would have a lot of umpires in it, wouldn't it?
No, it's about the moments. Andre Galarraga's perfect game.
Mm-hmm.
That should be talked about.
Not Andres Galarraga. That's the hitter. But no, Galarraga.
The pitcher.
Is it Andres? Does he have the same name as the outfielder? I don't think so.
Let me check.
In any event, the Detroit pitcher, we know who you're talking about. And yes, that was a controversial call at the best and belongs in the court of controversy, along with Don Denkinger's call at first base in the 1985 World Series, which allowed Jorge Horta to be safe and Armando Galarraga, and allowed the Royals to go on and win that World Series. And I'm sure if you speak to any Cardinal fan from that season, you mention the name Don Denkinger, and they're going to go, right, well, he better be in there in that corner.
Exactly. That is an important moment.
And every game that Angel Hernandez has ever umpired.
Does have a picture of Angel Hernandez in there?
It's on the top of the door when you walk in.
It's controversial. Ah, yes, we've had the patron saint. But I think those are the kinds of things. I think baseball fights should be in there.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's something that have littered the game for the entirety of its... I mean, how could you talk about Ty Cobb without talking about him going into the stands to fight people? Because that's not on his Hall of Fame plaque.
And then what happened after that was they suspended Cobb because he went, and so the Detroit Tiger players struck, and they put a bunch of guys named Eddie from the farm field on the field, and they played like two games or so as Tigers and got their doors blown off, like, you know, right. 30 to nothing, right. And all that kind of stuff. That is a story that baseball should embrace and hold on to. We need to talk about that. That's part of the history of the game, and it gets buried if you don't have areas. Now, they might have that kind of stuff, right, in the Hall of Fame. Along the way, not in the corridor of controversy.
Now, are we lucky in some respects because the Ty Cobb thing happened so long ago that we look back on it as sort of an amusing historical anecdote, whereas like if you looked at like the NBA and their malice in the palace, that's kind of looked at as a black eye on the league that they would rather never talk about again. Like, why do we look at those two things as different?
Well, because they happen 70 years apart.
It becomes a more whimsical folktale because haha, that old Ty Cobb fellow.
So we mentioned 10 of the guys. The other guy that we didn't mention and that I think you and I both feel should be in there, I don't know how he's not. I guess the only reason is controversy, PED Association, Manny Ramirez.
We talked about Manny being in there a bunch, but I think he would go into the PED section where you're saying, look, there are all these guys. And then enshrining them, I don't know if that makes it them easier or harder.
But to get out of the corridor of controversy?
To get out of the corridor.
Well, you said they could be in both.
They could be in both. I think the fact that they could be in both, because they should be in both, because Bonds probably did take steroids or PEDs or whatever, but he was a Hall of Famer before that. Like, the guy won back-to-back multiple MVPs like multiple times in his career. I don't think anybody's ever done that before.
And the idea that so many people say, well, these are cheaters. Like, all they do is like they cross them off as if they were able to make the assessment on the basis of all of the information that they have available.
Like the idea that like only these guys were cheating.
Right.
And like somehow or
the other guys just didn't do it. They were much much higher level than that. Yeah.
They were just cheating better than all of them. Like, oh yeah, if you were just taking Barry Bonds as steroids, you would have been as good as him. Like, no, that's not how it worked.
So another guy that I think would be on that list, and we've talked about him before, Clemens's sidekick there, Andy Pettit, who has borderline Hall of Fame stats,
is a guy that's confirmed. He was confirmed PED, though he was not.
He admitted to taking it. Right. Right, he's trying to get back from an injury. So does he belong in the corridor of controversy? Certainly, I don't think he belongs in the Hall of Fame.
I think you would talk about him in the corridor of controversy. I mean, you could even talk about controversial decisions in a baseball game. Pulling Blake Snell from the World Series game.
Yeah, like, that would be like you'd have a section called plays. And you just would
and these controversial plays
like that.
Where like you would, or decisions or moments in these games where a team went in a direction choosing to steal, like a guy getting thrown out, stealing a base.
To end the World Series like Babe Ruth in 1926?
Exactly. Yeah. Like, why was he doing that? We didn't, especially Babe Ruth, who is not known for being fleet of foot as far as
he
I'm
stole
aware.
A lot of bases, which just tells me that they weren't very good at throwing in
at
those
throwing
days.
Throwing the ball out, yeah.
And another guy who is coming up for, I think, this year on the ballot, and we just talked about him because you thought he was going to be maybe a first ballot guy, and I think he's going to get in the corridor controversy for me before he goes in as a first ballot, and that's Carlos Beltran.
Ooh. It's interesting because it really depends on where you lie on
playing career first.
Playing career-wise, he's in.
I agree.
The guy is a gold glove, multiple-time gold glove center
400
fielder,
home runs.
400 home runs, 70-something war. he was the best center fielder for like 10 seasons straight.
Yeah, yeah. So now you've got the whole, and why does he sort of headline, right, the Astrogate thing such that he's the guy that's going to take the fall for everybody?
He was not known as the ringleader for it, as far as I'm aware.
I wouldn't necessarily say that.
I
would say that he is the one guy who's been pretty honest about the fact that, we were doing that.
Right, never got the insight that he was the mastermind behind it.
I don't even know if anybody has been in.
I've heard it was Cora.
Okay, maybe.
That it was his system, at least.
Maybe.
But I don't really know. They've never really figured out, like, who was the one that gave the order to go ahead with this or, presented the idea, so to speak.
But you'd agree that Beltran is going to suffer from this or not, do you think, when he comes up for election next year? These writers,
I think
they're going to ding him.
I think they'll ding him because he won't be a first ballot guy.
Yeah.
And I think he'll get in. Because it's close enough to gamesmanship that they'll let it slide.
Yeah.
Because it'll be easy. Is it that different than stealing the signs with a guy on second or the old hidden ball trick? Like, this is the rationale people will be able to give. Is it that, unlike, you're not introducing something outside the game. Steroids were never a part of it. We were already stealing the signs. They just came up with a way that was a little outside the rules. It's not like you're bringing in and putting something in your body that's unnatural.
I see. The thing about the Astros thing, and we don't want to get too bogged down on this, that's most interesting to me, is that there was like a warning from Major League Baseball that they shouldn't do this. Like, so Major League Baseball knew the Astros and other teams were doing this kind of thing. It wasn't just the Astros doing it.
It was the same thing with the sticky stuff. Major League Baseball was like, look, we know what's under this rock here. We really don't want to look at what's under this rock because it won't be fun for us or anybody else. So please don't make us do it.
That's what the Court of Controversy is about. We're going to look under the rocks.
Right. It's because that was the problem with steroids. Major League Baseball for so long was like, well, we don't want the players to do it, but we're not actually going to make it against the rules. So but we're going to look down on anybody that does it.
I have two more players that I have in the Court of Controversy, just as players. I was thinking about their careers, and they got talked about a lot. One in particular this year.
Well, I think the other group that's probably good, you would see fans and players argue should be in the Corridor of Controversy would be owners.
Oh, well, it's funny because somebody said if you're going to take people out of the Hall of Fame, mm-hmm. Tom Yawkey, who was the Red Sox, owner for years and kind of a lot of nasty stuff came out sort of after about, what was really going on there, would be a guy who should lead the owners in the Corridor of Controversy.
Some of the teams moving and stuff like
that. Oh, and owners like Marge Schott, who, got herself into a lot of hot water for some of the horribly racist statements she made when she was owning the Reds.
Exactly. Those are some of the things that should be in the Corridor of Controversy, because those are some of the more unpleasant elements of the game.
Why don't we want to not talk about this or have people know about them? So if you take a little kid to the booth and they never hear, it's like, Pete Rose, never heard of him. Was he a baseball player? Are you kidding me?
But then it's even more confusing because then people will wax poetic about him. Oh, Pete Rose, he was so good.
Right. Oh, they called him Charlie Hustle. Wait, what does that actually mean? No, that kind of hustle. I mean, he actually ran hard and tried really hard. Not that he was a hustler. Well, he was a hustler.
We called him Charlie Hustle because he was just a representative of a good, hard-nosed baseball player that did the right things the right way. So he's not in the Hall of Fame.
But we want to put guys that have a chance to get out of the Court of Controversy and perhaps also be enshrined into the Hall of Fame. So you'd be in both.
Well, part of it is that, one, you're only going to generally put the more high-profile cases in there because nobody really cares that, like, what was the pitcher that got busted for doing PEDs for the Mets multiple seasons?
Oh, no, that was the Yankees, actually. Steve Howe.
No. Didn't one of them...
Oh, Henry Mejia.
Yeah. Nobody cares about hearing Henry Mejia's story in the Corridor of Controversy.
Or Steve Howe, who I think the joke on Steve Howe was 7 strikes and you're out. I think he got busted for coke possession like 6 times and he got 7 chances to be a major leaguer.
That's like
we've had enough.
That's like a funny story, but that doesn't need to be in the Corridor of Controversy. Because ironically, in order for you to be a big controversy, you kind of have to be somewhat of a big player. Like, the only reason we care that Ryan Braun did PEDs is because he was Ryan Braun and he was actually pretty good. If Ryan Braun hit 180 with no home runs and did PEDs, one, people probably wouldn't find out, or even if they did, we wouldn't care or be talking about him.
Dick Allen's name came up because he was passed over by the Veterans Committee this year to get into the Hall of Fame. And I am one of those people that believes he should be in the Hall of Fame. And the reason he's not in the Hall of Fame is not necessarily, in my opinion, because of his play. It's because he was a surly guy who didn't really, you know, follow the rules in terms of the way he comported himself, was not great with reporters, but statistically and for a long time was one of the best players. And I think it's almost like a writer's blocking of him being in there because they didn't like dealing with this guy. And so they just froze him out of the Hall of Fame. He was controversial because of some of the statements that he made and the things that he did. But
And it's interesting because you're just going to see a change in how the writers have pets. So yep. The writers of before had pets, pet players, because they liked the player. They did good stories, or they just they gave great quotes. There are some guys that you could just talk to. They know how to give you a great quote.
Like Ortiz.
Mm-hmm. And then there are other guys that talking to them was like talking to at best you would get cliches out of them. That was probably more frustrating, were the guys that were clearly smart, but would just unendingly give you the nothing cliches.
Ted Williams was known for like being the worst interview. He hated writers, wouldn't talk to him, but he was so darn good that they couldn't keep him out. Like, he didn't get voted in unanimously because he had enough of those writers that wanted to ding him for not talking to them.
So you have writers that have pet players now because they like talking to them. You're going to have writers in the future, you know, my generation, they're going to have writers that always players they follow in statistically. They're going to have like some kind of statistical profile that the writer happens to view as superior. Like, oh, maybe it's like that they're like, you know what? They're like a Met fan like me. And so they're going to look at a Keith Hernandez style first baseman 20 years from and be like, no, you don't understand. He played really great defense. And yeah, sure, he didn't hit it for a ton of power, but he hit for good average and all these doubles. He's a Hall of Famer because you love that statistical profile.
Like you would for Ozzie Smith. I'd seen some things about, you know, well, Ozzie Smith only batted 262 for his career. Of course, what did you say? His defensive war 44? Was 44 career. And you know what? D-war is a good cumulative stat. If you've got 44 D-war, that's about the most reliable stat of telling me that that's a good player.
The problem with D-war is that it's positionally based.
Mm-hmm.
So
shortstops will always come out higher than first baseman.
It's also about your ability to aggregate score. So like Keith Hernandez has like a just above zero D-war. I think he's got like a one something D-war, which
we've talked about that,
which doesn't sound great, but that's when you find out he's like one of the only two first basemen that have a positive D-war at first base. You're like, oh, wait.
I guess that does mean something.
It does mean something because it's just so hard to accumulate. So I think that's one of the difficulties like with advanced statistics is that it can be very difficult if you don't know exactly how they're being used to tell what they really mean. So D-war is, I think, like one of those things. Like, okay, he's got a lot of D-war, but what does that actually mean?
Right, right. And we've found a lot of guys who were known as good defensive players, and you look at their career D-war, and you think, wow, it's not nearly as bad as I thought it would be. You know, you think it would be much worse, but sometimes you can't affect a D-war if you don't play in a position that's really all that critically. Like Gary Sheffield's defensive war is not awful. He wasn't a terrible, you know, defender, even though he got worse and worse as his career went on, because he didn't play a position in which
you left field, right? Have a average, being an average defensive left fielder is not that different than being a really, really good defensive left fielder. Like maybe you get,
you're not going to get that many more points.
Right. Exactly. It's not like being a really good center fielder or shortstop.
So another place in the card of controversy, and I think that this guy is in represented with exhibits in the Hall of Fame because he was a very good player. But as we say, if you're going to be in the Hall of Fame, and I think this guy probably deserves a place, but not somewhere between being a player. And this is what we talk about with managers who are good managers and good players, but not great necessarily at either. You have to put them in as either a player or a manager. And what we argue, or I do at least, is that the aggregate contribution of their career on both should be considered. And this guy as a player and an activist, like Kurt Flood, was the guy who challenged the reserve clause in 1970. So he was a very good ball player and got traded from the Phillies to the Cardinals, I think. It could have been the reverse. And he refused. He says, I'm not piece for sale like that. I'm challenging this reserve clause, and I want to be a free. So he took one, not just for the team, he took one for all of baseball, because it was his contribution that paved the way for free agency when Andy Messersmith and Dave McNally went free agent in 1975. This is a watershed time in baseball. It's 50 years ago. And so you're not going to enshrine him as a player. He was a good but not great, you know, player in the field.
Yeah, yeah.
That contribution, it was controversy, right? Because, you know,
I mean, it was
he got kicked out of baseball, basically. I mean,
yeah, he basically ended his own career to give the rest of the players free agency.
I want
to
hear that story. And I'm going to guess, I haven't been to the Hall of Fame in a while, we really do need to go, that there could be places where you might see that. We think there should be an aggregated area where all this controversial stuff
So basically
stuff
what
exists.
He says, so he got sold to a different team. And he's like, wait, why should I have to choose to be sold to that team? Why can't I let other teams bid for me?
Right, right, exactly.
So, and it sounds so simple
now,
but back then, I'm sure
challenging the reserve clause. But we paid for all your meals when you were eating in Double A or something like that. Yeah, we gave you a dollar, you know, to have lunch, and so we've taken care of you the whole way, and you are our property. That's what the game was.
Yeah, I'm surprised that argument didn't fly so well.
Well, and I think players would like even to be less restricted, and so that we're still in this sort of detente between ownership and players, where the owners want to take control because they've made an investment, right? The signing bonus, the, you know, training of the player. But over time, the players are like, look, we already get paid for what we did, not for what we'll do, right? That's the way baseball is. And I think you'll start to see a shift where players are going to get paid earlier in their career for what they're doing. And that would probably incorporate free agency being Wildcat, just
right,
available
right.
To everybody.
I think you, the guys are going to be more willing to take shorter term contracts consistently.
I think if you want to make money, if you're, you know, we're Met fans. So if you're Pete Alonso, right, if you were on the open market right now, you signed a three-year deal, what do you think Pete Alonso would get compared to what he's getting right now?
As long as he performs basically at this level, he'll get to sign an even bigger contract 3 years later.
Aaron Judge is showing everybody, I gambled on myself.
Max Scherzer.
Yeah, yeah. How can a guy get paid $43 million a season and be worth it?
Well, you go on your pitch like you do on yesterday.
So the court of controversy, you know, yeah, it's not necessarily a backdoor, because we're not saying they should be enshrined. We still think they should be considered for future enshrinement. And I really like your idea that you would put them in both, that they would exist in both areas. Let's do it.
Thanks for listening. Subscribe to our podcast on your favorite platform.
And you can follow us on Twitter @AlmostCooper.